all the exit streams is the same as rate of its entrance, right? So that would give me, let's say, rate at which it's exiting is from the stream 2. From the stream 2, this number multiplied with this number will be the rate at which is exiting. This number multiplied with this number and this number multiplied with this number. Okay, so that will give me 0.93x1 plus 0.24x2, I suppose. Yeah, 0.24x2 plus 0 is equal to rate at which is entering is 6. Okay, and that's it. You can write for the third one also, but that would be redundant. That would be a redundant information. It's not a unique information. I mean, it's not a new information if you write for the second one, because that can be formed by using these three. You can show that it's very simple. It's just because the balance, if you do overall balance and the two component balance, third component will always already be balanced. Okay, it's a physical necessity. All right, so we don't need to do that. And therefore, I have this set equation. Now, what I do is I can write it down in terms of matrix notation. That will be 1, 1, 1. So I'm going to define my unknowns as a column vector. So maybe let's first do that. So unknown is a column vector, which are x1, x2, x3. Okay. And this is multiplied with a matrix that would be, can be written as, this is first equation, first row is first equation. So first row of this matrix would be first equation, second equation, and third equation. First row will have x1 coefficient as 1, x2 coefficient as 2, and x3 coefficient is, sorry, not 2, but 1. 1 each. 1, and x3 coefficient is 1. Second equation, x1 coefficient is 0.54, and 0.26, okay, and 0.93, 0.24, 24, and 0, okay, and that should be equal to 10, 2, and 6 each, okay. So, this has a form of A, X is a matrix, X is a vector, that is equal to B vector. Okay. So I have to solve this. Well, you can do it on your, you can solve it, of course, using pen and paper. But for large systems, this is a very simple 3x3. You have three variable system. But if you have multi such variables, many such variables, then it becomes a little tedious. And you need to, so now here at this point, I want you to be familiar with the typical methods, usual methods, Gauss elimination, Gauss-Jordan, etc., Hamilton-Jacobi Jacobi method, etc. I hope you are familiar with those methods. If anyone is not familiar, you have to let me know now. Have you all seen these methods which are typically used to solving linear systems? Gauss elimination, Gauss-Jordan, Jacobi method, okay, and there are a bunch of other methods, but let's not worry about that. But I hope you have all seen that. Anyone who has not seen, please let me know. Okay, good. So you know these methods, and you should be in a position to implement them. So given A, so you have the problem statement is AX equal to B, you have to solve for X, okay, given A and B, all right, so that is typically the statement of the problem. You can solve it by, so I want you to try, you want to write your own codes for in all these methods. Okay, I will not be talking about the details, the mathematical details. You are all familiar with that. Just look up those algorithms. What is the scheme in each case, and how to implement it on computers to solve large linear systems. Okay, so that would be very useful, and I want you to do that. If you have any question, you can let me know. And I will. Maybe I can spend a day, maybe giving you just the algorithms of each method. Let me see if I can have it. Yeah, probably. Let's not worry about it since you have already done it. So I will not do it separately. And if you have any question, I will address them. You have to try it yourself first. Okay. All right. So these are some methods that you can yourself implement. But at the same time, you can also resort to inbuilt MATLAB functions that can do it for you. Okay, so typically the way it's done is, it's very simple. If AX equal to B, then all you need to do is X is obtained by A. Well, actually, this is not recommended. You don't have to calculate in words. So basically, what MATLAB, if you give a command, an analogous command, basically the command that executes this operation is A / B. Okay. So if you just do this, okay. So this this will automatically solve the X given A and B. Okay. So by the way, this forward slash. So forward slash means divided by. Okay. And / is divides. Okay. So for example, let's go to MATLAB. Okay. So this is what we were doing in the last class, I guess, right? CL clear console. Let's clear everything. Start afresh. Clear all the variables as well. Oh, my system is slow. What is taking it so long? Okay. All right. So now let's say 6/6/2, we get answer to be 3. And if I do 6/2, I get 0.3. So 6 divided. So this is like 2/6 is written like that. Okay. So now let's just try to implement the problem that I stated, where I had A matrix given as A matrix is this one. Okay. A matrix is here and B is here. So let's construct those matrices and then solve in MATLAB. Okay. So let's say A is equal to 1 1 1 :0.04 0.54 0.26, okay, 0.93 0.24 and 0. Okay, if you just hit it, that is the matrix that you have on the left hand side, and B would be column vector given by 10, 2, and 6. Okay, and then you can just write X equal to A / B and hit enter, and here is your answer. Okay, so so basically MATLAB has inbuilt, this is an inbuilt thing that if you issue a command, if you just give 6 number, that is interpreted just like it divides. Okay, but if you have a matrix a vector, that will be like A inverse B, and that will solve, that will basically find out A inverse B. Okay, but remember, this is not a scalable way to obtain an answer, and you should be By the way, when you give this command in MATLAB, MATLAB is not going to actually calculate A inverse and then multiply with B. It has inbuilt procedures where actually it looks for the best scheme, maybe Gauss elimination or Gauss Jordan. And by implementing those schemes, it actually comes up with the answer. It's not going to find the A inverse of A and then solve this. Okay. So it also does the same thing that you would have done for large scale problems. So it kind of makes your life easier. All right. Okay. So that is what I wanted you to be familiar about. How to, if you have a relatively large looking linear system, you can quickly find an answer using MATLAB. Okay. Don't have to wait for very long or do it yourself in a tedious manner. Okay. So now, next, what we have done so far, we have basically learned about linear systems. Of course, I have not talked about that in great detail because this is something that you should be already familiar with. Okay. And how to solve in MATLAB. Okay. You have learned about nonlinear algebraic equation. Sorry. In one variable. How to solve this? A non-linear algebraic system of equations in many variables. Okay, this is what we have so far been able to, this is the useful thing that we have learned so far, how to solve these kind of problems. Okay, and related kind of problem, we have seen how, where such related kind of problems may arise, some examples of those. Now, next kind of, these are basically related to algebraic equations. These are all algebraic equations where you need to find a value or a set of values, right? So, however, there is another kind of, now the next kind of problem that we are going to discuss are actually differential equations, okay? So, differential equations, and we have already talked to some extent. So, kind of differential equations we are going to meet. They will be ODEs and PDEs, of course. We have seen examples of these. Okay. ODE will be having two kinds of equations we look at. Boundary value problem and initial value problem. Okay. So let's, and PDE, we look at, let me just tell you about this. Definitely we look at parabolic equation, elliptical, and hyperbolic. Well, I will not have probably time to go to all of those. Let's see how we do. So ideally, I would like to do all of these, but definitely I'll try to do these two. Let's see if we have time for this or not. I do not. I'm not sure. Okay. And so we will look at first thing, initial value problem. That's the first thing. Okay. So initial value problem, what is the problem? Now this initial value problem, it can exist in one variable. That means you can have one. Of course, it's a ODE, so it's one. There's always one independent variable. Okay. And there can be more than one dependent variable. If there's one dependent variable, or you have more than one dependent variable. Okay. So this is called system of IVP, system of initial value. Okay. So system of ODEs, first order ODEs, right? All right. Now, let's look at the simplest case. I have one dependent variable. So I'm going to write this as dy by dt. T, I'm going to take as the dependent variable. And a general form of the problem is this. This would be the governing dynamical equation. I mean, this will tell me how y is going to change with time. Okay, the functional form of f will decide how y will change with time. And you have to find that particular function y of t. The solution would be y of t. Okay, and of course, this problem is incomplete without specifying the initial value. So we have all seen this, right? You all know that. So this would be an example, and we have seen the examples of where such kind of problems may arise. For example, chemical kinetics problems and reaction networks, etc. Okay, that's where we can actually find these kind of equations. In general, I can write down, if you have multiple variables, okay, so then you can write on dy by dt is equal to f y comma t. Okay, that would be the case when you have more than one variables, okay, where y is actually representing all dependent variables, which could be y1, y2, etc. So you have a reaction network with multiple species, and you want to find out how the species concentrations change with time, given the initial concentrations. That would fall into more than one dependent variable initial value problem, right? So that okay. Now how to solve? Okay, of course you want to find a function that would be that would satisfy this condition. It's like you've been given a puzzle and you have to find out what kind of function actually will satisfy this kind of condition expressed by the differential equation. Okay, all right, now let me ask you guys this. Have you studied Euler's method? Okay, so I'm going to write down something and I'm going to ask you or you guys, because I don't want to spend too long discussing on the mathematical the formulation of methods. I don't want to spend too much on that, okay? But some basic things I want you to be aware of, okay? Then trapezoidal method. Then idea of explicit and implicit method. What are the explicitness versus implicitness of a method? Okay, stability of a method. Okay, and Rangakatta methods. Okay, stiffness, the concept of stiffness of a problem. Okay, and then system of IVPs, eigenvalue method. These are the things I want you to be aware of, and I may discuss them, but not at great length. So therefore, I'm going to ask you which ones you are aware of, which ones you are not. You have to let me know now so that I know I have to have an idea about how to proceed. So tell me first, is the Euler method is done? Just first one. Oh, I see. Okay. So you're not aware of trapezoidal method. Are you aware of the explicitness or implicitness concept? Has that been taught, the explicitness or implicitness? You know about trapezoidal method? First one is Euler's. Second one is, Satvir, you are saying first one. The first one is Euler, then you are saying trapezoidal only. So that means these two you are familiar with these two? Anyone who is not familiar, you have to tell me now. Even if someone is having difficulty in understanding these, okay, not the first one. No, 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 not the integration. That's wrong. Not the integration. Well, the idea is involved here. So this is not for, well, idea of integration is involved here, trapezoidal rule for integration, but it's not for integral, solving the integral, no. Well, this idea of the trapezoidal, it's called trapezoidal method, but I'm not talking the trapezoidal rule. Okay, this is, although trapezoidal rule is used to arrive at this method, but I'm not talking of that. Oh, I see, then none. Really? You're not aware of Euler's forward or backward methods? Even that is not done? The forward Euler and backward Euler? No, 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 Pawan, not necessarily. No, not necessarily. Is linear functions? No, 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 not necessarily. We'll see that, but let me just first ask you. I'm not referring to trapezoidal rule, which you know for calculating or estimating integrals. No, I'm not referring to that. I'm referring to the method which is devised on that particular rule to solve differential equation. All right, maybe then I can probably tell you a little bit about all these ideas in detail, little bit detail. That will take some time, but... Okay, so one of you probably says Euler and RK. So that means Euler must have, anyway, let me not worry about that. Maybe you might have forgotten or out of touch. So let me probably just remind you. I presume that you've already known that, but anyways, that's fine. Let's look at Euler's method. Now, by the way, these methods, all these methods that I've listed here, they are based on, they're called finite difference schemes, finite difference methods. So what is a finite difference method? Basically, what you do is you approximate the derivative. Okay. You approximate the derivative by a finite difference expression. What does that mean? Well, first thing, suppose I have dy by dt. What is that defined as? It's basically y at t plus delta t, y at t divided by delta t, limit delta t goes to 0. Okay. This is our definition of dy dt, right? And using this, and your problem says dy by dt equal to f of t comma y, okay? And now I want to solve this, and after I solve this, I will always solve it in some range of time, let's say t, whatever, t equal to 0, to t equal to some number equal to capital T, okay? And I'll have some, this would be the exact solution. Let's say the exact solution looks like this, okay? And you are going, so this is actually, if your method is absolutely correct and your equations solves this differential equation, I mean, your answer actually satisfies this differential equation at each point, okay, any point you choose, then you have an actually exact solution, right? This is an exact solution that you would obtain if you were perfectly correct, okay? But when you compute on computers, okay, if you can do it on pen and paper, if you can solve this, then you will get exact solution, okay? If you can do that, if you can actually integrate this and find y as a function of t, you will be able to get exact solution. But that's not always possible. You can have very complicated looking expressions on right hand side as f, and you may not be able to solve it analytically, and then you will resort to computers. But when you do it at each point, I will probably choose some discrete set of points, okay? Because I cannot have infinite numbers, I cannot process. I cannot have all the points, all the time So t will become a discrete variable in that case. Okay. So t becomes in computing represent in compute in order to implement it on computer, I have to discretize the time. Okay. So independent variable is first thing you do is discretize the time. This is basically a requirement because of my digital computing limitation, right? So digital in nature, you have to be finite number of I can actually do the calculations with. Okay, so discretize the time. When you discretize it, naturally you will divide into some time steps and there will be time delta t. Okay, this would be time step. Okay, so if there are, let's say, k delta t would be equal to t2 minus t1, here maybe I should call this n, because I'm calling it k. There are n number of steps and delta t will be t2 minus t1. This is final time, or I call it capital T, right? So I would stick to that notation. N delta t would be equal to capital T minus zero, which is capital T. Okay. So this would mean that I'm starting here and K would be my step index. Okay. So this would be zero is equal to zero. Time is also zero. There's time is capital T and K will be equal to 1, 2, 3, etc. And this time value T would be equal to 0, delta T, 2 delta T, and so on. Okay. And you have n such points that will be divided. So n would be decided by capital T and delta T. Okay. T divided, capital T divided by delta T will be n. Okay. So these are just some of the nomenclature that you should get accustomed to, because we'll talk in terms of these quantities. Okay. So now you have discretized the time. Once I've discretized the time, then the question comes, how do I write my equation that is actually not for time? This equation is not applicable to discrete time space. Okay. Now I have, this equation is time can take any value, right? So this is a continuum. This is basically for applicable to continuous time variable, right? Okay, so I want to represent the same equation if time was actually discretized, and that would be basically left hand side is approximated by simply delta y by delta t. Okay, that would be, which would mean y t plus delta t minus y. So this will basically y at k plus 1 minus yk divided by delta t. Okay, where y at k plus 1 is, suppose you are any time t where the step index is k, then all I need to do is look at the next time k plus 1, okay, and the current time and take the difference, okay, and divide by delta t, the step size. Okay, that will give me an estimate of the derivative at any particular point. Okay, this is basically this approximated dy by dt is approximated by delta y by delta t, and that is, you all know that, right? Okay, so that would mean at any discrete time step, okay, say tk, and so I can write down yk plus 1 minus yk. Or maybe I can write it down like y at tk plus 1 minus y at tk divided by delta t. That would be equal to f of tk yk. Okay, yk is, so well, maybe I can further make it a shorthand, and rather than writing as y tk plus 1, I'll write yk plus 1 and yk. Okay, so maybe I can just change this, and instead of writing this, I'm going to write it as yk plus 1 minus yk. Okay, so I'm going to write it as yk plus 1 minus yk. Okay, that is my form of the this is called finite difference approximation of my derivative, and this is actually called forward Euler equation. Okay, what is happening? Okay, I'll tell you what's happening here, but first let me write down what are we gaining here. So this way I can write down yk plus delta t f of ek yk. Okay, now what does this relationship tell me? If I know yk, okay, it tells me that if I know yk, if this quantity so if I know yk, if this is given, I already know my delta t. I know how I have discretized my time. So delta t is known to me. Function is given to me because that's from the problem statement. Function is known to me. And at k, I already know tk because I know k is known to me. Delta t is known to me. So I can find tk. And yk already I have said I have known. So right hand side is known to me. So knowing yk, I can calculate yk plus 1. Okay. And this way you can keep on moving. So if I know yk plus 1, I can calculate yk plus 2. If I know yk plus 2, I can calculate k plus 3 and so on. So this way you can proceed. So this is basically, so you have to start somewhere. So suppose I know y0, which is actually initial value problem. So if I know y0, I can find y1. Knowing y1, I can find y2 and so on. So at each time, I will find the y values. And therefore, if I had to access that, looks like t equal to 0 and k equal to 1, 2, and corresponding three t values, delta t, 2 delta t, 3 delta t, and so on. Okay, then at each point, I'll have some answer for y. Okay, I do not know how will that look like. And these set of points would be your computed answer. Okay, this would be the solution of your IVP. Okay, and your actual curve, let's say t equal to 0 is over somewhere here. So your actual curve may look like this. I do not know. And you may be actually falling short of some amount. I do not know, but it depends on the method. Okay, so there will always be an error. Okay, so this dotted curve is what you have computed. So dotted curve would be shown like this. Maybe I just join with the straight lines, dotted straight lines like this. Okay, so this could be your exact solution. Okay, and this could be your computed solution. Remember, you will never get exact solution because you're already compromising in your when you approximate this this thing by this thing, you're already compromising. You are actually moving, you're losing infinite number of information between two consecutive points. You're only doing it at a finite set of points, whereas this equation is applicable to all set of points. Okay, so you are actually because of that loss of information, you are not going to get exact answer. Okay, but the name of the game is how to get most accurate result. Okay, but and there are certain associated other issues when you compute. What are those other issues? That's what we are going to discuss. So first thing, this is called forward Euler method. What are we doing here actually? If you look at the way what I have done here, you have actually, so imagine this simple graphical way to understand this. So suppose this is your time step, this is your kth step, and this is your k plus oneth step. Okay, let's say this is my k minus one step. So ideally dy by dt would be will be basically a slope of a line which would be like this. Okay, so this is the slope of the line is dy by dt. What you're doing is you're basically writing like this, okay? And your other line is a red line, okay? So red line is exact value, okay? So slope of, oops. So slope of the exact line, which is in red, is approximated by the green line. Okay, because you see dy by dt, you wrote as yk plus 1 minus yk divided by delta t, right? So yk plus 1 is this value, yk is this value, so this is yk plus 1, this is yk, and this length is delta t. So this, so yk plus 1 minus yk is basically this length, and delta t is this length. Okay, so this length divided by this length is actually tan theta. Okay, so you are actually replacing the correct tan theta by an approximated tan theta value. Okay, and this is called forward Euler, because what you are doing is your current point, the rate of change of the variable at the current point is estimated by looking at what would it be at the next point. Forward, you look forward. So at current, so rate of change of the variable is estimated by looking at, looking forward basically. Okay, meaning at the k point, I'm looking at the k plus 1th point and finding the y value at k plus 1th point and then looking at this derivative, okay? So that gives me forward Euler method, okay? And that way, so this allows me to approximate the answer at each discretized time points, right? Okay, so this is, now what can go wrong here? What can go wrong? Of course, you are kind of overestimating the rate of change. You may overestimate the rate of change. The derivative may be overestimated. Okay. And therefore, there is a possibility of losing, basically, there's a possibility of moving too, I mean, changing y by too high value as compared to the actual solution. Okay, so for example, if there is a function that at any point it changes very sharply, okay, and here my slope is this much, and if you take your delta t a bit larger, then you will actually, your y value will change by very large amount as compared to what you would have expected. Okay, so you, this constraints basically, you have to make sure, you have to ensure that delta t is sufficiently small so that derivative is not overestimated. If you bring delta t very, so if this length is, depend on the time step here. Okay, what is going to happen is, what is going to happen when you take too big a time step, you are going to get unstable answer, okay? Constraint on delta t, okay? So if delta t is too big, okay? So if delta t is too large or larger than some threshold value, so if delta t is
larger than a threshold value there would be your function will sharply blow up. Your answer, actually the computed answer, not a function, but the computed result, computed answer, computed approximate answer, whatever you call it, approximate solution will sharply blow up. Remember, you are doing it, so like if you make a huge error in the first step, the second step you do the same thing, you will make even bigger error. Okay, so error will actually be extremely large if your delta t is large enough and the function is very highly oscillating, not oscillating but highly, I mean changing with a very large rate, or that the derivative is large. Okay, in that case, if you are overestimating too much, you are going to perform the same error again and again, and you will quickly get an answer which would shoot up to, which would be unphysical, which was completely wrong, etc. Okay, so these kind of methods are called unstable methods. Okay? Well, it's called con so this is basically what I mean by stability or unstability of a method. Okay, so when this happens, you say that the method is unstable for that choice of delta t. So basically, the Euler method is conditionally stable or unstable. So we can say that Euler's forward Euler is stable only if delta t is below a threshold value. That would actually be conditionally stable. I mean, it's stable as long as this condition is satisfied. Okay, conditionally stable. Okay, there are some methods which are completely unstable. You can actually devise a method which may appear good to you, but it would be unstable. Okay, so unstable method is a method that never, for any value of delta t, it will never, it will always blow up. So an unstable method, okay, blows up, or oops, method gives a solution that blows up for any choice of delta t. Okay, that is what the stability means. Okay, now let's say how to get rid of this problem. How do we